Hi, I'm Ronan.
And I'm John.
In this video, we'll be giving you more information about lifts and extensions for FTC.
We will discuss different mechanical options for extending and powering, along with how to detect that a lift is retracted and how to install wiring.
This is a follow-on to our first lifts and extensions video, and we would recommend that you watch that first if you haven't done so.
There are many different properties to consider when comparing these options, including the size, how wide and deep each option is, and its weight-to-length ratio. For this, we will weigh different options with the standard extension of 36 inches or roughly 90 centimeters. We will also measure how stable it is by extending it horizontally and putting a 1 kilogram load on the end.
Aluminum extrusions, such as these by Riff Robotics, can be connected to each other using these double-sided Delrin sliders. This assembly is 82 millimeters wide, but is very light, 490 grams per 90 centimeter extension. With a load, they bend 4.5 centimeters in the forward direction and 10.8 centimeters sideways. There is some friction when extended or retracting due to the rubbing of the Delrin sliders against the aluminum. If they are impacted while extended, most of the force is against the Delrin plastic pieces, which may not hold up against extreme force. To power them with strings, Riff provides small bearings which can be screwed into the aluminum extrusion and then attached to a motorized spool. However, 3D printed bearing covers are needed to prevent the string from falling off. To extend to 90 centimeters, this requires 5 slides, which can be bought for about $40 total on the Riff Robotics websites, which is one of the cheaper options out there.
Aluminum drawer slides, such as these Mizumi SAR230 slides, can be connected to each other with these 3D printed or CNC'd pieces with bearings. They provide a compact and light solution, only 41 millimeters wide and 520 grams per 90 centimeter extension. When extended to 90 centimeters, it droops 9.5 centimeters in the forward direction and 2.5 centimeters to the side. These drawer slides have very low friction when compared to other options due to their roller bearings. They are hard to mount due to their limited number of holes. You may need to drill additional holes for mounting to a kit chassis. 3D printed parts are also required to attach the bearings for stringing. This option is expensive though, adding up to about $75 to $100 for a 90 centimeter extension on the Mizumi website. There is a discount to $15 per slide if you buy more than 5.
Aluminum X-rails, such as these by Activotics or Go Build Up, are connected using these end caps and use a classic pulley system to extend. They are very smooth and easy to mount. Due to this design, there is very little friction while extending and retracting. It is difficult to maintain all of these wheels at the correct tightness, which can lead to reliability issues. When extended 90 centimeters with a 1 kilogram load, it droops about 5 centimeters forward and 8.5 centimeters sideways and weighs 700 grams, so they are one of the heaviest options. Also measuring 88 centimeters wide, this fully prepared system costs about $75 from Servo City.
Now we'll talk about some other options that aren't used as often. These linear rail slides, sometimes called MGN rails, are made of steel and have a roller bearing block which moves along them. Movement is very low friction because of the ball bearings, and the steel structure makes it very strong. We didn't connect these together to measure droop, but we suspect the droop will be very low because of the rigidity of the steel and the tightness of the blocks. They would be difficult to mount, and you will probably need to drill extra holes into the steel to connect them to your chassis. Additionally, you need 3D printed parts to attach multiple slides and bearings. Enough of these MGN 12 slides for a 90 centimeter extension weighs 1,250 grams, making it the heaviest option. The cheaper option can be bought on eBay for $17 each, but you have to be careful when removing the blocks to avoid having the ball bearings fall out. Similar options from Mizumi or IGUS can be $100 or more per slide.
In summary, this table shows you the main properties of the previous options. This is a lead screw style lift. It works by utilizing a spinning lead screw to move a platform up and down. It is incredibly strong and supplies a rigid platform without much flex in either direction. We and many other robots utilize this style of lift in our Rover Ruckus gear to hang our robot. When joined with a high RPM motor, it can move at a moderate speed. Another advantage is its simplicity, as it does not require a lift to string. A major disadvantage is its limited range. It can only extend the distance of the lead screw. Another disadvantage is its speed. It takes about 3 seconds just to travel the length of the lead screw.
There are several ways to power a lift. The most common method is to run strings through to a spool connected to a motor in a continuous path. We discussed this in our first lifts and extensions video. To enhance the control of your lift, a pull-down string is highly recommended, even for vertical lifts. They increase speed going down and keep the pull-up strings on the pulleys. Sometimes they can have varying levels of slack throughout the lift path. Using a spring attached on the end will solve this issue. It is very common to use multiple motors to power the lift. When doing so, it's important to mechanically connect the two with either gears, chains, or belts.
If you are extending horizontally, another option to power it is with a linkage, as shown here. This is the fastest method for powering linear movement. Make sure to keep the motor axes and the pivot axes perfectly linear to push the slides out as the motor rotates. The linkage also serves as a return method for the extension. Be careful with the motor or servo that you choose, as it will need a lot of torque.
Lifts require a way to stop so that they don't go down too far and risk strings falling off the spools, especially if there's no return string. Sensors are the best way to do this. This is a rev magnet sensor. It detects the magnetic fields of a magnet and returns a true or false. It requires a strong magnet, but is easy to mount and doesn't need contact. This sharp analog distance sensor sends infrared rays out and then measures the reflected IR values after bouncing off of something. It needs a large object to detect when a lift is at the endpoint. These are easy to mount and do not require contact. Limit switches, or touch sensors, sense physical contact. We have found that the lift is prone to bouncing when hitting a limit switch. Limit switches are also harder to mount due to the non-standard hole layout. In summary, here are the pros and cons of different options for sensing that the lift is down.
To power the electronics at the end of your lifts, cable management is required. This coiled cable is easy to mount, but comes in a set number of wires and lengths. It is prone to catching due to every retraction having a slightly different path. A cable drag chain, as shown here, can protect any number of wires and is fairly easy to mount. It only comes in some set lengths, but can be extended. The downsides are that it takes more room than the other options, and removing or adding wires is difficult. This video shows a wire loom. It can be any length and any number of wires, but it is hard to mount and perfect. Once it is functioning properly, it extends and retracts perfectly every time and is easy to take out wires. The final option is to create your own large coil as we did for Skystone. This takes up a lot of space and is hard to set up, but allows for many lengths and numbers of wires. In summary, here are the pros and cons for the different options of putting wires through a lift.
We hope you found this information useful.
As always, you can contact us via email, Discord, Instagram, or leave a comment below. Thank you.